Please be joined this morning by the county executive from Baltimore County, Johnny O. Johnny Olszewski. Good morning, county executive.
Hey, sir.
C4, Brian. Good morning to you both.
Always great to have an opportunity to speak with you when your schedule allows. Let me ask you, county executive, last week you and your police chief, Melissa Hyatt, came up with an idea to deal with businesses that have been deemed public nuisances. You already have currently the ability to deal with them or punish them or close them if they have been convicted of certain activities. In this instance, you were looking at modeling yourself after Baltimore City and going after actually, you know, accusation type of thing. Explain what you would like to do with this public nuisance bill.
Sure, and we've seen in Baltimore City, this is a public nuisance law that has not been used often. It's about having the tool. We're not looking to close businesses unless they are affirmatively not being a good actor in the community. So this is a law about not allowing any property in Baltimore County to become a haven for illegal activity. And this is a proposal that gives the county the enforcement mechanisms we need to actually make sure they don't. So this is really just strengthening our existing public nuisance or padlock law. This is about giving some real teeth to it. As you mentioned, this is modeled after what other jurisdictions, particularly Baltimore City, already has in place. And, you know, look, I hear loud and clear from our residents. They expect us to do whatever we can to keep our community safe. And so this is really about giving our police department the tools they need to address truly problem businesses and properties where criminal activity is occurring repeatedly or being reported repeatedly, to go in there and actually make sure that we shut down activity that shouldn't be happening in Baltimore County.
Well, that's where the question, though, comes in. It's because the change would allow you to close it down if there was the report of criminal activity in that two-year period, not a conviction, just a report. Does that go far enough? I mean, to just say that there was a report of it versus actually getting a conviction, because if it is that big of a problem, then shouldn't you be able to get a conviction?
Well, the current standard is pretty high, and as we know, particularly with COVID, courts have been very slow to process cases, and so you have to have those convictions also within a particular amount of time. But communities want action. If we know that we're taking reports and there is documented activity that shouldn't be happening, occurring, we want to be able to make sure that we can go in and shut things down more quickly so things aren't allowed to fester or become a deeper problem. There is due process built in. There are appeals, not just to the administrative officer, but also through the administrative law judge process. And, you know, it's not our intention to actually close down, but to just having the ability to say, if you don't take responsible actions, business owner. And again, these are the worst of the worst actors. These are not your typical businesses, but these are places where we've seen criminal activity, and there are very few bad actors. But we want to make sure that we can take action, as we've seen in Baltimore. This is legislation and authority that's been used, but it's used very infrequently, again, just for those worst actors that are out there. And unfortunately, we can't always get to the table without having this enforcement power.
As you mentioned, Baltimore County Executive Johnny Olszewski, who joins us right now, in Baltimore City, it's only been used really twice, one by Commissioner Fred Bielfeld with a very notorious entity on North Avenue, Linden Liquors, and then another situation under Commissioner Kevin Davis with a gas station that was on Forest Park that was basically allowing drug dealing to occur inside of the gas station. But the president of the Towson Communities Alliance is in the Baltimore Sun talking about some concerns specifically about Eastern Towson. I don't want to call out any businesses, county executive, but is that something where you are putting more attention, like more, Police Chief Hyatt, more attention in certain areas?
Yeah, interestingly enough, our current padlock law was last used many, many years ago by former Chief Jim Johnson. And even then, he was calling for the changes we're seeking now. And I'll say for Towson or for any community, we are a very data-driven police force. And so anytime we're seeing activity or, frankly, we're also being responsive to community concerns, we are stepping up patrols, not just in East Towson, but throughout the Towson Entertainment District. To both be responsive to the concerns of residents, but also to follow the trends and go in where there are hot spots. Because on crime across the board, C4, we've been clear that Baltimore County is welcoming of anybody who wants to visit. But if you come here and you are intent on committing a crime or doing something that's illegal, we are going to find you. We're going to arrest you. We have a very high clearance rate, way above the national average. And you're going to get prosecuted here, too. So we don't tolerate it. We won't accept it. And I think our numbers bear that out. And folks understand when you're here, we're going to do that.
Well, I was going to ask you about that because I believe we're up to 68 murders now in the city. It's almost one a day. Nothing has gotten better this year, and it was a tough year in Baltimore County last year as well when it comes to those types of crimes. Have you seen a decrease? Do you feel like you have it more under control this year as compared to last year and what we're seeing, especially as you compare it to Baltimore City?
Yeah, so I will say what I remind folks is that we're actually a jurisdiction that's larger than most others. We have over 850,000 residents. But I'll also add that it's early in the year, but we are seeing encouraging data on that front in Baltimore County. We are actually seeing a notable decrease year over year, but again, it's early in the year. We're going to make sure we keep stepping up. We keep closing cases. We keep letting criminals know, like, this is not the place to commit crime. We're seeing, again, year to date, we're at over 50% decrease from last year. We're going to do everything we can to continue to enhance public safety, to arrest criminals, and but also to make sure we're providing those upstream investments that help prevent crime in the first place in Baltimore County, whether it's rec opportunities or job opportunities, investments in our schools, so we're identifying children who could use supports. Because what we want to do is catch people early so they don't turn to crime. But we also are being clear that if you commit crime, we're not going to tolerate it here. And again, we're seeing encouraging numbers year to date on that front.
Baltimore County Executive Johnny O, when it comes to the office that you created, and I want to give you credit for creating the Inspector General of Baltimore County and her office, you did put money in your budget last year to get an additional person, but that gets that office up to three. Baltimore City, less smaller than Baltimore County, has a staff of 17 in our Inspector General's office. Are you looking to increase at least the staffing in the Inspector General of Baltimore County? Because they really are coming up with a lot of savings for the county.
Yeah, C4, and again, I want to just reiterate, we were proud to have created the Inspector General Office in Baltimore County. I've been thrilled and honored to support its growth every year. Obviously, we are tasked every year with considering budget requests that ask us to balance public safety investments versus education versus IG, but we have grown it every year. It's my intention to try to find ways to continue to grow it. Baltimore City's office is bigger, but I'll note that was actually grown over time. We're growing it, and I hope that it's one of the legacies, candidly, that I want to leave behind is an office that includes the positions necessary to be sustained beyond my tenure, so that that work can continue for years to come here in Baltimore County.
Ali brought that up really quick, kind of executive, because just in the border billing situation alone with Baltimore City, that office has identified millions in terms of lost revenues. And I just think with reports like that, the more staff is there, the more money can be saved for your taxpayers. That's the only reason I brought it up.
Absolutely. And both the city and county IG actually built on the work that we started with then Mayor Young, where we actually had an independent group already looking at those water issues because we knew that that's something that needs to be tackled. There's a report out there now, and so we continue to want to do any sort of approach that will help save that money for our residents, our citizens. As you know, we don't have direct or operational control over the water system in Baltimore County, but we certainly are ready to be at the table to work with our partners in the city to do whatever we can to make sure that that is a modern, efficient, and responsive system for our shared residents. We are the largest customer and a partner in it.
It has been noted, though, David Plymire noted this in The Sun, that the Baltimore City Inspector General's office has a much bigger budget, like a seven-time larger budget than one in Baltimore County, and has like 15 more employees. And as you mentioned, Baltimore County is much bigger than Baltimore City. So can you get to those numbers to give the Inspector General, Kelly Madigan, more manpower in order to do some of the investigations that are probably slow to get to now?
Yeah, I mean, I remain committed to growing the office and sustaining the work because, as you pointed out, there have been some really great examples of ways that we can or should be better, either individually as a government or collectively with regional partners. As I said before to C4, you know, that office in the city was not something that was grown to that size overnight. But we are committed, again, balancing the constraints of a budget with folks who want to see us invest in public safety, people who are asking in our town halls for more school investments, counselors, and all the results of the pandemic. So we're trying to balance all those investments and grow all of those things in a responsible way And so, again, it's my commitment that we are moving towards a larger office so that we can sustain more work. What that actually looks like will be dependent upon the budget process that we're currently in.
Baltimore County Executive Johnny O, when it comes to Annapolis, legislative session is now past a halfway point. How is your agenda down there? What are some of the things you're looking to get out of this legislative session?
My number one, two, and three items are school construction. As you guys know, we have had a long-term plan for, 15 years, the multi-year plan for school improvement, where it called for investments in every school across Baltimore County, removing the need for trailers, and also raising, but I also want to raise the standard. That plan was built on existing funding, so we've been asking the state to step up to the plate with us, and to date they have been. We've gotten more money through things like the Healthy Schools Facility Fund, more money than we thought through Built to Learn. So we've been able to step up and do things like announce we're going to build a new Delaney High School, a like new Towson High School. We're going to elevate the standard for our other renovations, and we're looking for ways to expand pre-K, add more security investments. And so we're going to continue to ask for those resources to have more support, building on the new Lansdowne High School that we're building, new elementary schools and middle schools all across the county. And I just want to say, Speaker Jones, Senate President Ferguson, Governor Hogan have heard us. They've been at the table to help us. Again, this is a great year for capital. It's one time. It's not ongoing. Mm-hmm. And it will allow us to, in partnership, finally address the challenges that have been lingering for so long in terms of our school construction needs. And I just want to thank all the state leaders who have been at the table and who are working with us on that. But that's absolutely our number one priority in Baltimore County this year. And so far, signs are encouraging. We'll see the budget drop, I guess, officially next week, but we're keeping our eyes open for that.
Last question for me, and that is, we obviously had that incident at the Towson Town Center not too long ago with a whole bunch of juveniles getting into fights and, doing some damage to property within the mall. I guess my question is, do you know what has become of those arrests, number one? And number two, do you believe that the situation is more under control? Obviously, we haven't heard anything close to that since that time. Was it a one-off, or are you still kind of going to focus on making sure that the mall has more police officers on duty?
Yeah, so, Brian, I will try to get the disposition if we can on the cases. I don't have that in front of me. We do believe this was an isolated incident, but we're making sure that we're taking action to ensure that is the case. And as always, we always take action to make sure that we can prevent activities from happening again that we don't want to see. We stepped up in partnership with the mall, where we are doing more proactive training. We're doing a better job of sharing information. And for all of the businesses in that corridor in Towson, we've stepped up patrols and the police presence. And anecdotally, we've seen foot traffic the weekend after and since has increased. People have responded to our presence and our partnership in the community. And so there are leaders out there like Nancy Hafford of the Towson Chamber and Mr. Caligari, I think you mentioned earlier, who's the Towson community umbrella leader. We're constantly talking to them, partnering with them, and we are confident that we're taking the steps to ensure that the aberration that we saw remains so. And again, we're going to make sure that those children, these young people have to understand you can't act that way, and there are going to be consequences if you do in Baltimore County. So again, all are welcome, but those who break the law are going to be held accountable here.
Always great to have you on board, Baltimore County Executive Johnny Olszewski. And just to leave you with a little thing to think about next time that we talk, County Exec, and that is the State Department of Education has in a statewide assessment. I know you care about this being a former teacher, where our children just regressed so horribly during the pandemic in terms of standardized test scores statewide that we've really got to do something to catch our kids up. So we'll talk next time around, but it's been, the scores were just horrible coming out of the statewide standardized test, County Exec.
Absolutely. Looking forward, guys. Thanks as always, and have a great rest of the week.
I appreciate it. Thanks a lot. Look, Brian, as it relates to that Inspector General office, you can't tell me we can't grow more than three. A staff of three compared to Baltimore City, a 200,000 population less, a staff of 17. I get he's right. They've been, there for a few more years. But three people to do what they've done.
Yeah. three people with a budget of like $340,000 or something like that.
Something like that. 35 cents for each resident is what it works out to.
My math, Baltimore City has seven times the budget as what Baltimore County does, and they have a smaller population.
And look what they've come up with, though. Look at the reports when we spoke with Inspector General Madigan, Kelly Madigan, what they've been able to do with that small group.
Well, there's been just as much pushback in Baltimore County, if not more pushback, to the IG's office than we've seen in Baltimore City.
But I'm going to give him credit. He created it. He didn't have to create it. So let it roll. Let it grow. Let it bloom. let it blossom.
I believe that's Paul McCartney, isn't it? I believe so.